sweetest places. Broken souls with smiling faces, fighting for surrender, for now and the after, yeah.
Just look around and you'll see the people are scared to say how they really feel. Oh, we all need a little honesty.
You are loved if your heart's in a thousand pieces. If you're lost and you're far from reason, just look up, you are loved. Just look up, no, you are loved.
It feels
like something's missing. If it hurts but you can't find healing, just look up, no, you are loved. Just look up, no, you are loved.
We're not made to be superheroes. Photoshopped all size zeros, a lie not expected, but not quite perfected yet. Face up, see the sun, look up, see the sun is shining as the horizon, calling you, it's calling you.
You are loved, your heart's in a thousand pieces. If you're lost and you're far from freezing, just look up, know you are loved. Just look up, know you. Prove yourself. Don't try to be someone else. You don't have to prove yourself. Don't try to be someone else. You are loved. Just look up.
You are loved.
Just look up.
You are loved.
Just look up. You are loved. Just look up. You
in the name of Jesus Christ, welcome all to worship on this second Sunday in the season of Lent, a season of preparation and making ready for the festival of the resurrection of our Lord. But thanks to our youth this morning calling us to worship and reminding us that every Sunday is indeed a celebration of the resurrection of our Lord and of the love of God for us and for all. So thank you, youth, for calling us to worship, and thanks to the Bell Choir for being here today as well to add to the beauty of the holiness of our worship this day. A special word of welcome to those visiting this day. It is a blessing to have you in our midst, whether here in person or tuning in on our live stream. It is, again, a blessing to have you in our midst. We invite you to sign our guest card and put them in the offering plate so we may continue our welcome of you, or to send an email so, again, we may continue our welcome of you. So this is the point in the words of welcome where I normally say, everything you need for the service today you are holding in the bulletin in your hand. That is no longer true. We are continuing to move further and further past our COVID restrictions, and so now we are inviting folks to go back into the hymnal for three of the hymns today. That's that red book that's in front of you. And if you open it up, there's like music inside. And actually, for those who love singing the parts, you know, you'll be very happy because now you'll have all four parts instead of just the melody line. But so, that is to say, we are going to be using the hymnals with more regularity to try and save on paper. You notice a different format for the bulletin. We're experimenting a bit with size, with how much paper costs, seeing if we can't reduce some costs that way. So again, your feedback is welcome as we continue our exploring of these things. So, I believe those were all the logistical announcements you needed for today. As I always say, I invite you to stand and sit throughout the service. It is always as you are able or as the Spirit moves, such as now. I invite you to pick up that red hymnal, stand as you are able, as we join together in our gathering hymn. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who looks upon us in compassion, forgives our sin, and heals our lives. Amen. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where is my help to come?
My help comes from the Lord, the Maker
of heaven. The Lord will not let your foot be moved, nor will the one who watches over you fall asleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand.
The sun will not strike you by day, nor the moon by night.
The Lord will preserve you from all evil and will keep your life.
The Lord will watch over your life and
your coming. We sing together our Kyrie prayer for mercy.
Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy. Christe eleison, Christ have mercy.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, our leader and guide, in the waters of baptism, you bring us to new birth to live as your children. Strengthen our faith in your promises, that by your Spirit, we may lift up your life to all the world through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated, and at this time I'd like to invite any of the children who are here to come up for a minute. And Michelle, up in the booth. Yeah, I feel really loud and live. Can you bring down the volume just a smidge? Thanks. Good morning, everyone. Great job calling us to worship this morning. Yes, you are loved indeed. Oh, good morning, Jeffrey. So today in our Bible reading, we are going to hear a passage of Scripture that is perhaps the best known passage of Scripture in all the Bible. And it is from the Gospel of John, the 3rd chapter, the 16th verse. So I am going to spend our little time this morning helping us to make sure we know what that verse is, right? So I'm going to have you repeat after me so we can try and memorize this very important verse. Are you ready? So first of all, it's John 3:16. Can you say that with me? Very good. Now, does anybody know? I'm just curious how it starts. No? Okay, very good. This is how it starts. And so I want you to repeat after me. God loved the world so much.
God loved the world so much.
God gave the only Son.
God gave the only Son.
That everyone who believes in him. Yeah, that's a tough one, right? Let's try it again. That everyone who believes in him. Very good. Will have everlasting life. Right, so that's a lot of big words, right? And we're going to try it again, but it is a very important message, right? What we're memorizing, God loved us so much, right? God loved the world so much. God gave the only Son, Jesus, to us to know God's love so that everyone who believes in him will have everlasting life. So when you hear everlasting life, maybe you think about like heaven, a place where someone goes when they die. But what this really means is you will always have life with Jesus. Even and especially sometimes when you don't feel like you have much life at all. When you are feeling sad, you're feeling mad or unhappy, doesn't feel like good life, right? But because of Jesus, it is always a good life because he is always with us and loving us. So sometimes when we might feel afraid or sad, we can remember John 3:16. Can we say it together? Ready? God loved the world so much, God gave the only Son, that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. Will you pray with me? Dear Jesus, we thank you for the way that you show us how much we are loved. Help us to remember that always, especially when it's hard. Help us to know that you are always with us and you will always love us. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you for coming up. And Miss Lori is waiting for you in the back. Thank you, Miss Lori. And as is noted in the bulletin, this is a moment where we do like to pause to share any joys that we may have brought with us this day or some ministry updates as well. And I will start by saying it was a joy last Sunday to be gathered in this space for a congregational meeting following worship. It was recorded, and we're in the process of trying to send it out, but we're having a little technical difficulty, but we can still send that out for those who are not able to attend. The highlight of that meeting was me being able to share part of my journey and my discernment and an experience over this past year. As I had said a while ago, wondering if it was time for a different leader here at Gloria Day, and having thankfully, joyfully, blissfully come to the realization, no, it's just some little different leadership you need from me. And so in this coming year, to promise that that is what is coming, and renewed excitement and enthusiasm for this work that we are doing together this year. So praise be to God for that, and I look forward to this year to come. Next Sunday, it will be a joy to welcome Pastor Toki from Madagascar, who will be here. We have helped Pastor Toki through his seminary education, and there was a motorcycle involved at one point. But he will be here next Sunday to share an update on his journey through seminary and what he has been doing. So looking forward to that. The Sunday following, on the 19th, I'll be sharing my experience in Turkey and Greece in January. So looking forward to sharing that with you all. This last Wednesday, we had our first Wednesday night in the season of Lent. It was a soup supper with activities in the narthex, and then of course the sanctuary is open for some quiet time, reflecting time. There are resources. As you leave the sanctuary, you will see in the bookcase and on the tables for your time on Wednesday nights or for any time in this season of Lent. The church is open during the day. If you might need a time to stop and simply dwell, I invite you into that in this season as well. Just to note for the youth, two dates coming up, March 10th, March 26th. There's information in the bulletin about that. And the flower sale has begun, our annual fundraising event for outdoor property. The order form and the box to put it in is out in the center table in the narthex, so I commend that to everyone. And of course, next Saturday here at 8:30 in the narthex, all women are invited to come for a women's breakfast with a presentation by Vicky DeVilbiss on liturgical art and some of the beautiful things she has done over the year with regard to that. So far, those are the announcements I had to make. I'm saving one for the end, but it looks like, Terry, did you have an announcement to share?
I want to thank everyone who has supported the Browns Receives program this past few years. I do want to remind you that each receipt has to be stamped, and we now have a shorter time frame to turn the receipts in. We are done with 2022, so I hate to tell you this, but throw those away. I can't turn those in anymore, but we always have a month after the month that is on your receipt. So we will be turning in January's this week. You have all the month of March to collect February's. So just, I know I used to keep them in my pocket and every now and then throw them in the box, but now we have a short time frame for the receipts. So thank you again.
All right. Thank you, Terry, and thank you for managing that. And Kathy, you have an announcement too?
Yes. There it is. Okay. So a couple things. Susan asked me to share about the women's prayer breakfast next Saturday at 8:30. She is going to be setting up on Friday, so if anyone wants to help, contact Susan Denver, so she doesn't have to do it all alone. And then the youth night is actually the 12th, not the 10th. The youth are all going to come, and we're going to do some planning for the Easter egg hunt, and we're going to gorge ourselves on pancakes because we have a bunch of pancake mix and syrup left. So that should be actually pretty fun. But on Easter, we're going to do an Easter egg hunt after the service for our children and for the children in the community. So in preparation for that, when you're walking around Target and you see a package of eggs or a package of candy, please pick it up. And in the coat closet, there's a gray tub. That's where we'll collect those donations. Little candies, little toys that will fit in eggs. So I think that's all I have today.
Thanks. June, you had something
sure.
as well?
Well, good morning. I wanted to share yesterday that I participated in a workshop with Reconciling in Christ. And this is a partnership that ELCA has formed with churches. Right now, about 12% of the Lutheran churches participate in this program. Based on yesterday's participation, I see that number increasing. But I want to talk to you about what the mission is. The purpose of Reconciling in Christ is to ensure the welcome, inclusion, and celebration and advocacy for people of all sexual orientations, gender identities, and gender expressions, work for racial equality, and commit to anti-racist work and support the national programs. I think this is a really important program. It's about 11 steps that we go through. It takes, you know, like a year. It takes some time, a lot of discernment amongst the community here. And I would encourage everyone, the next training is in May. If people have interest or questions or just curious, encourage you to participate in that. It was about $75, so it was reasonable. I learned a lot. A lot of discussion about this community being the most marginalized community in the church, and that's true. So go learn, and I hope we'll be able to talk soon about our journey.
Very good. Thanks, June. Charlie, you have an announcement?
There is a sign-up genius for the soup suppers on Wednesday. There are several slots for this week that are open, but you don't have to wait until 1 week before to sign up. We have the whole 5 weeks of Lent, please sign up on the sign-up genius for that.
Yes, there is a link in your bulletin to help sign up to bring soup or maybe set up or take down tables. And also out in the narthex on the bulletin board, there's a sheet with the QR code. You can just take your phone, click, and you'll be right there. All right, very good. All right, well, so one thing I did not mention in my words of welcome was an invitation to everybody following worship today out into the narthex for a time of fellowship. But there is also cake. There is cake because today is a day of celebration, and it has been very well kept under wraps until now. And at this time, I would like to invite Jill Lowe to come up and meet me at the altar for a minute. Yes, Jill, that's you back there. Hi, Jill. So, Miss Jill, for those who don't know, has headed up our community outreach efforts, all of them, for the last 20 years. Yes, and there is a whole litany of things I have here, of things that Jill has done and helped lead us in our mission to be the hands and heart of Jesus for one another, our community especially, and the world. So, back to school supplies, bake sales for veterans, Christmas in October, food and turkey drives, the baby pantry support, Super Bowl Sunday, personal care quilts, Lutheran World Relief, Christmas for Seafarers, Angel Tree, Anne Arundel County Children. I can go on and on, but fortunately, since Jill has discerned it's time for her to retire, she has put all of this information about all of these ministries in this binder and has handed that on to us, to all of us. And so today is a day where we do want to pause and to say thank you, Jill, for everything that you have done. There is cake, there are some gifts, but none of this can fully express the gratitude of all of us for all that you have done. And I know that this is the last place you want to be standing, but please, I invite you to take a moment to receive our appreciation. And the best part is, she's going nowhere. And is still going to be managing one of our most intense ministries, our Neighbors in Need Fund. Every day, we get at least 5 phone calls for help. And between Jill and Kathy, managing all of this so faithfully, I'm so thankful for this partnership in ministry. So, thank you, Jill. All right. God bless. I now invite us to prepare our hearts and minds for the reading of God's Word.
The first reading is from Genesis. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Romans. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the Scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. It is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs. Faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, "I have made you the father of many nations." In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you are able. Oh God, amidst the truth of light, creation's glory be. Grant us the grace to keep your word and live in love redeeming. All flesh is grass, the flowers fade, and time is The Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I've told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Dear family and faith, grace to you and peace from God, our Creator, and our loving Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Well, after having read John 3:16, perhaps the most famous passage of all scripture, as I said to the children, which Martin Luther called the gospel in a nutshell, well, perhaps there's no need for a sermon, right? Or the shortest one ever, for which you all might be thinking to proclaim, "Thanks be to God." Not yet. I mean, there's a reason John 3:16 has become perhaps the most well-known verse in all of scripture. Though, to be very honest, I really wish verse 17 were as popular as verse 16. Verse 17 saying, "God did not send Jesus to the world to judge the world." Unfortunately, especially among some of our sibling Christians, that is where they miss the boat, right? With so much judgment. No. God did not send Jesus to condemn, but to save, to forgive, to strengthen, to incite love, action with one another. How good it is to return this day to that most beloved gospel in a nutshell, to be rooted and grounded again in the clear and simple, profound truth. God loved. God loved the world, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. No, not God was frustrated with the world, not God was annoyed or angry or bothered with the world. He loved the world so much that he gave us Jesus that we might know what love looks like. The Son given not as a judge, but one who saves, as I said, and as Luther says, from sin, from death, from the devil, saving us from all that would separate us from one another and from God. Such gospel, such good news, which is appointed to be read on Sunday morning, not nearly enough, some might say, and which is appointed, along with our other readings, to be read every 3 years on the second Sunday in Lent. And might anyone know what happened here 9 years ago on the second Sunday in Lent when these texts were read? I preached my very first sermon at Gloria Day. And at the time, I expressed gratefulness for the appointed gospel reading, being able to say to all of you on my first Sunday here, God loves you so much that God has given Christ for you. And then I expressed gratitude for the appointment of the first reading about Abraham and Sarah, and how perfect it seemed, given where Gloria Day was 9 years ago in its life and history. I said that the passage from Genesis, that book of new beginnings, in which God was calling Abraham and Sarah to journey from what was, from everything they knew, all their comfort, all their peace, into something unknown, that is what was happening here at Gloria Day. We had 35 years with Pastor Tom. We all knew how everything worked, how everything happened, what was going on. And then that changed. And just like Abraham and Sarah, who were sent out into the world not knowing where they were going, but only, as that beloved prayer goes, that God's hand was supporting them and God's love was leading them, so too we at Gloria Day ventured out. And here we are 9 years later. And has everything for this congregation been easy? No. But there have been good things that have happened, and we have been blessed indeed, especially coming out of pandemic prominence. It seems like yet once again, we are at a place, joining Sarah and Abraham, looking into the future, not knowing exactly what is going to look like, but trusting that the Holy Spirit goes with us. Again, the story of Abraham speaks that powerful word in those instances, just like now, as we continue to emerge from what we knew to what we don't know. And whether that be as a congregation, or in our personal lives, or as a country, moving forward into the unknown and unfamiliar, into experimentation and change can be scary. And of course, there will be ups and downs, joys and sorrows. But it is one filled with promises, the promise of the presence of God. Meaning today, as we continue to move into the future, we can ask as a congregation, as a country, as an individual child of God, where do you see death? Where do you see death right now? In the congregation, in the community, in the country, in your life, where do you see death? Because that is where the Spirit can bring life. Do you remember, born of the Spirit and of life? Where in our life do we need resurrection? Where do we need saving? Maybe a new birth in our relationships, in this community? As Jesus told Nicodemus, who came to him under the cloak of darkness, God's Spirit is on the loose. It is. And in the waters of baptism, we are reborn each day, beloved children of God, and sealed with that Holy Spirit, empowering us to go to all those deadly places and to bring life with the confidence that, like Abraham and Sarah, we venture with that Spirit. So I ask, where might that need to happen for you, for us? Where and how will the Spirit move in and through you this week, bringing life, saving others? For that is the promise of God, which, just like for Abraham, for us too, is all gift and depends on faith. So, dear ones, in the hymn we're about to sing, we're going to hear about that work of the Holy Spirit of God at work in all those who've been born of the Spirit, born from above, born again, born anew each day by water and the Spirit that brings life, power, and peace. And I pray that like Nicodemus, you too might be on the lookout for the new things that God is doing in this congregation and in your life, because you have been born again and anew, and you've been joined to Jesus in those waters of baptism. So, may you sense that Spirit this day, dear ones, blowing where it will, giving you life and hope and peace and a desire to share God's love with all the hurting world, for which now then we all can say, thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able. Our hymn of the day is in the bulletin because it comes from our new hymnal. So you will find that, as I said, in your bulletin, and we sing together.
So it is with the Spirit of God. As the heart made strangely warm, as the voice within the storm, so it is with the Spirit of God. Never seen, never known where this wind has blown, bringing life, bringing power to the world. As the dancing tongues of fire, as the soul's most deep desire, so it is with the Spirit of God. As the rainbow after rain, as the hope that's born again, so it is with the Spirit of God. As the green in the spring, as a kite on a string, so it is with the Spirit of God. Making words that are new, making peace come true, bringing gifts, bringing love to the world. As the rising of the yeast, as the wine at the feast, so it is with the Spirit of God.
In us, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we prepare for a time of intercessory prayer for the church, the world, and all those in need. I commend to you our congregational prayer list printed in the bulletin. Just to provide some updates to our prayer list. We have been asked to pray for Sue Stubbs' uncle, Richard, who is in rehab anticipating aortic valve replacement. Jan Bell asks that we hold her mother Jo in prayer, and Charlie as well, as they are entering hospice, and her friend Mike, who's recovering. Mary O'Connor has asked we hold her mom Teresa in prayer as her health fades. Christine Shea's mom fell and is recovering, so we've been asked to pray for her. Her name is Sharon, so holding Sharon in prayer. As well as June Glynn's mom, Jerry, as she is tended to with hospice care as well. So those were the additions and updates to the prayer request I have. I would, Donna, did you have a prayer request as well?
Just continue prayers for Ron so that they can determine what's causing the leg pain that he's suffering. Also, he's having basal cell surgery on his face this week, so prayers for that.
Oh, thanks. Well, I invite you to stand as you are able as we join together in prayer. Come, bring your burdens to God. Come, bring your burdens to God. Come, bring your burdens to God. For Jesus will never say no. Come, bring your burdens to God. Come, bring your burdens to God. Come, bring your burdens to God. For Jesus will never say no. Holy God, you so love your church. Raise up leaders who care for your people. Bless lay theologians, seminary and college professors, and all who are called to the ministry of teaching, that they form and inspire us for the work of the gospel. Continue to inspire us as your people gathered as Gloria Dei. Fill us with your Spirit as we move boldly into the future you are preparing for us. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Holy God, you love your creation. Breathe new life into our planetary home. Guide the work of researchers, scientists, and activists who love your Earth and who inspire us to care for the natural world. We lift up those who suffer by creation, especially in Turkey and Syria, asking that you continue to give them the strength that is needed for this time. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Holy God, you so love the world. Uphold leaders who resist tyranny and oppression. Strengthen organizations that promote peace and harmony. Direct their work to alleviate human suffering and to address its root causes. We ask for your Spirit of wisdom to rest upon our elected leaders, that they might do their work according to your will. We ask that you continue to keep and protect all those in the military striving for the peace you so desire. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Holy God, you so love your people. Draw near to all who live with mental illness, depression, addiction, or any sort of illness in body, mind, or spirit. Accompany them in healing and recovery. Hear the cries of those who look to you in their distress. We especially lift up to you this day Richard, Joe, and Charlie, and Mike, Teresa, Sharon, and Jerry. And we remember all those others on our congregational prayer list, and all those known to each of us to be in any sort of need, whom we now name before you in the silence of our hearts. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Holy God, you so love your children. Bless the young in our midst and delight us with their joy, wonder, and curiosity. Revive our ministries with children and youth and equip us all for faithful discipleship. Merciful God, hear our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. And I invite you to share a word and sign of God's peace with one another. And you may be seated as we receive our morning offering. Please stand as you are able. Let us pray. God of goodness and growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is sure. Word and water, wine and bread, these are signs of your abundant grace. Receive the gifts we bring and nourish us to proclaim your abiding love in our communities and in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that, renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 Lord God of power and God of might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. I commend to you on page 9 some words of invitation and instruction for Holy Communion. But to emphasize here at Gloria Dei, all are truly welcome to the table where Jesus invites all to taste and see the goodness of God. Those choosing to not commune this day are still invited to come forward, simply offer a sign, and you will receive a blessing. I do now invite the communion servers to come forward.
Thank you.
Please stand. Now may the body and blood of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, that you have strengthened our hearts through this feast of life and salvation. Shine the light of Christ on our path, that we may do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you now and forever. Amen. And we sing together our ascending hymn. One brief announcement before the benediction, a reminder of the cake and celebration following the service today, and in the upper room where the children gather, there is need for help with folks for that 20 minutes on Sunday morning that the children spend upstairs in that upper room. There is a clipboard right out here in the narthex that says Sunday School. Just two to sign up each Sunday as we are in this interim time with Terrence having left. So I do commend that sign up for you. Resources are available. So please do consider spending that time with the children upstairs. So now receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.